up as far as you can see its bumper.
Got a bird's eye view, and it certainly doesn't look good from up here.
The tank is full. The engine's humming. Those wide open roads are beckoning. So sit back and get ready for Motoring 89. Brought to you by Quaker State. The big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will. This week on Motoring 89.
Ronnie, you got a status for us?
Yeah, wait a minute. The limousine actually starts as a Lincoln, as you would know it, exactly the same. And then gets cut in half, stretched, it's welded together.
And welcome to the Phoenix International Raceway. We are here for opening day of one of the most exciting racing series in North America, the Kart Indy Series. And behind me, the starting grid, and on the front row, the story of 1988, the Penske Racing Team, Rick Mears and Danny Sullivan. But this is 1989, and the story for Canadians can be found just a few rows back. Ludwig Heimrath Jr. and Johnny Jones. With that story, let's join Steve Grant.
When Johnny Jones lined up last year on the Phoenix 200, he was the youngest driver in the field. In fact, he had never even driven an Indy car on an oval circuit. Well, he didn't finish the race, but he did go on to win the Rookie of the Year honors. Now, this year, Johnny's with a new team, he has a new sponsor, and people are looking for big stuff from Johnny Jones.
Bottom any place? You didn't lean on it either, though, did you?
Well, you can't become Rookie of the Year twice, obviously, but, you know, we just want to be in the top 10 and consistently up in the top 10, not only finishing races there, but qualifying and running there all the time. And, you know, that's our you know, one of our goals this year, and to qualify at Indianapolis and race there and, you know, just do the best we can in the championship.
If John Jones sounds confident, he has pretty good reason. He opens the 1989 kart season reunited with the Protofab Racing Team. That's the same team that helped him win the IMSA GTO Championship in 1985.
You know, the atmosphere around the team is a lot different. Now, you know, they accept that I can go fast. They know that I'm competitive and can drive fast. So it's just a matter of me learning and us learning together. I mean, learning and say, okay, what does John want the car to do? Let's get him comfortable in the car, and then we know he'll go fast. Whereas last year as well, once John learns, then we can get that. I mean, it was, you know, it was more of a, once you figure out, the car's already set. Whereas now we're saying, look, we've got to get the car to what he wants. And together we're going to figure that out, and then we'll be competitive and we'll be right up front. So it's a totally different atmosphere and attitude towards it, and, you know, it's a lot more comfortable for myself and the team.
The thing I'm most proud of is the fact that he's maturing very well, and hasn't gone to his head. He's still the same guy, and he's very dedicated to the sport. He wants to go all the way to the top. He knows it takes a long time. He's not in a big hurry. He doesn't want to be a hot dog.
Ludwig Heimrath Jr. makes up the other half of the Canadian kart connection. Last season was an exercise in frustration. He enters the Phoenix race with a realistic attitude.
What I've learned most important of all is just you gotta be tough and you gotta keep trying. I mean, things, you know, everybody said that last year was a real bad year and this year's gotta be better. Well, that's not necessarily the case. This year could be just as miserable as last year. We could have 14. Bad races this year for whatever reason, and I think that even if that does happen, all you have to, you know, what you have to say to yourself is, so what? Carry on to look ahead to next year.
The 200 laps get off to a great start for Ludwig. Even a track veteran like Ron Hemmelgarn gets caught up in the excitement.
Ronnie, got a status for us?
Yeah, wait a minute. Things are going real good. We just gained stop there by that yellow, so all we need now is one more pit stop, so we're in good shape.
Okay, come in this time, tires and fuel this time.
Run! Bit of a scare there. What happened?
He's having clutch problems. The clutch is going out. So when he went to exit to pits, the engine stalled, so they had to push start him to get him going. But we're in now. We're running 10th. Poncho's in front of us. And there he goes, right where we're being the points.
Just a few yards away, Johnny Jones gets a bit of a scare himself when fire breaks out. Luckily, he wasn't badly injured, but he did have to drop out of the race. As for Ludwig, he finishes in 9th place, and remember, he started this race in 22nd spot.
One down, 14 more to go, baby. That's one top 10.
Ludwig, you okay?
Oh, I'm just glad we're finished. It was a tough race. Boy, it was a struggle all the way. We had one set of tires that was really vibrating bad, but when we got that set off, things started to smooth out a bit.
Great way to start the season.
Yeah, crew did a great job.
Great job, dude. Very good. Very good.
Next on Motoring 89, Mazda's initial van, the MPV.
There's a rough road ahead with no end in sight. Quaker State engines don't know when to quit.
Quaker State is the only motor oil with QSX, quality engineered to exceed every single car maker's Canadian requirements for maximum engine protection. So pistons are protected from friction mile after mile. Valves are protected from wear year in, year out. That's why Quaker State engines run strong and run long.
Quaker State engines don't know when to quit.
The big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will.
Test Drive with Graham Fletcher.
This week on Test Drive, we're looking at a vehicle that falls into perhaps the fastest growing market segment. This is the 1989 Mazda MPV. Now, don't let its size deceive you, because inside there's a lot more room than you might at first think. Let's go. Because of the style of the vehicle, we decided not to put it through the pylons, but just to run it through these country lanes. You've got some pretty good switchbacks. And for a van, although it feels like it's going to fall over periodically, it handles very well. It's certainly one of the stabler minivans I've driven. Surprising, the MPV really doesn't ride and drive like a truck. You always, or I always, associate rear-wheel drive minivans as being too truck-like, because they're based on a truck platform and then they've added the van body. But the MPV is surprisingly firm and yet still supple and comfortable. In a van like this, you sit very high off the ground, and with the large expanse of glass, the visibility is very good. We found a nice straight stretch of road, so we're going to run the Mazda MPV up to 100 and see how long it takes. So I suggest you hang on. Shifting at the red line, which is one good sign. Got it. 11.6 seconds. That's fast. The decelerometer's in place, and that means one thing. It's brake test time for the MPV. Now, each week we use this device to determine how well the brakes are actually working. As you begin to hit the brakes, the liquid will drop from the zero position, and the lower it goes, the better the brakes actually are. As soon as we hit 80 kilometers an hour, we're going to throw the anchor out. If you're ready, hang on. We're doing pretty good. We dropped down around 28 there, which will be, when we use the conversion chart, around 105 feet or so. One of the MPV's few drawbacks is that you limit the seating capacity to 4 people if you fold up or remove the third seat. Our test vehicle featured Mazda's two-zone air conditioning system. This allows the cooling to be tailored individually, a very satisfactory system indeed. On the heat side, there's an auxiliary heater hidden under the driver's seat, which provides a plentiful supply of warmth to the rear passengers. The dash is very well laid out. The instruments are clean and uncluttered and convey all the relevant information at a glance. The rotary controls for the heater, however, tend to be a little too far away from the driver, meaning that you must stretch.
The engine in our MPV was Mazda's powerful 3-litre V6 18-valve unit. This engine debuted in the popular 929. When the MPV is equipped with this engine and the appropriate towing package, you can actually haul a trailer weighing up to an impressive 4,300 pounds. Matched with this engine is a 4-speed automatic overdrive transmission. This transmission features both power and economy settings as well as a hold feature. I found the trans upshifted too quickly in the economy mode and you had to force a downshift to prevent the engine from lugging. In the power mode, the shifts are crisp and well coordinated, giving the MPV a much peppier feel. The hold function holds any given gear you select. You may hold first, second or third. If you hold third, when you pull away, you actually pull away in second. This prevents the transmission from becoming overheated. I felt that an overdrive lockout would have been a better setup. The rear wash wipe is a must because the rear window seems to attract the dirt. Of all the minivans, the MPV is perhaps the most attractive. Lots of glass gives it a light, airy feeling, and the fender flares a sportier appearance, minimizing the boxy shape. Inside, the MPV provides you with everything you'd expect of an expensive sedan, plus almost limitless versatility. Needless to say, I was impressed with the MPV.
Multi-purpose or multi-passenger, the MPV fits the bill. Now, normally I have my pet peeve in and around now, but this week, because a lot of people have been hitting on Mazda for having a side-opening door, I figured I wouldn't bother because, personally, it didn't bother me. However, if you do park in a tight space, you might be wise to unload your passengers before you get in there. Anyway, that aside, let's go to the scoreboard.
The MPV reaches the 100K mark surprisingly quickly. In fact, I was amazed by the 11.7 second time it turned in. The handling characteristics are very good. It hides its truck-like traits very well. However, if you push the MPV hard into corners, be prepared for the amount of lean. I think the sensation is, in fact, worse than the actual amount of lean. The brakes pulled up in a straight line with no nasty surprises, all in all acceptable. 70 decibels is respectable, and there is very little wind or engine noise evident. Our test vehicle turned in 11.7 litres per 100 kilometres, which is approximately 24 miles per gallon. More than fair for this type of vehicle. My overall rating? In short, the best minivan around at the moment.
Seatbelts, very effective safety restraints, but only effective if they're worn properly, as we'll show you later on Behind the Wheel.
When Motoring 89 returns, Bill Gardner looks for the proper mix.
Well, if you're looking for a mechanic, this is the place to be. We're in the garage area here at the Phoenix International Raceway. This is where the crews try and get every ounce of performance out of their machines. Well, our chief mechanic, of course, on Motoring 89 is Bill Gardner, and his performance is on his mind this week.
Last week, we talked about inspecting and replacing the spark plugs and the plug cables. This week, we're going to carry on with the tune-up, and a good place to start is by removing the air cleaner assembly. It'll expose all the filters and sensors around the carburetor. Before you start, take stock of where all the vacuum hoses and fittings that are attached to this assembly are located. If you get into trouble, you can always refer to the emission hose routing diagram underneath the hood. With the air cleaner assembly removed, we can identify all these parts now. The fuel filter, located in here, the PCV valve and hose, the choke thermostat and heater, the carburetor linkage, choke plate and carburetor linkage, the two choke vacuum brakes or pull-off assemblies as they're sometimes called, the EGR valve. Now here's an interesting little item that causes a lot of people problem. You may have started your car first thing in the morning and noticed that it runs very rough for the first minute or two, belches out black smoke, and just doesn't run well. Quite often, failure of one of these two components, the choke pull-offs or choke vacuum brake assemblies, or maladjustment of either one, can cause the car to run excessively rich waste fuel, black sooty smoke out the tailpipe, and that's quite a common problem with cars today. These things need to be checked and possibly adjusted or replaced. With a carbureted car like this one, the first thing you're going to do in the morning on a cold start is hit the throttle to set the choke. Here's what happens. The choke plate closes fully in order to shut off all the outside air and give the engine an extremely rich fuel mixture from beneath this choke plate. Now, as soon as the engine fires up, it's important that this choke plate tips open immediately and slightly to give the engine some outside air for good combustion. We're going to isolate on this particular component the choke pull-off or choke vacuum brake assembly to show you how it does that. Using a handheld vacuum pump, we're going to apply vacuum and see that choke plate tip open. There's several possible faults with this. If it doesn't open far enough, the car runs very rough with a sooty black exhaust. Or if it opens too far, like this, the car will start and stop, start and stop. You might have to start the car 3 or 4 times before it'll run on its own. Or if this unit has failed, it may not open at all. And in that case, you have to replace this component and adjust the new one. We should mention that it's important to check the function of all these choke components while the car is cold. It may mean leaving it overnight at your mechanic's shop or checking yourself on the initial startup. Once you've done so, you can reinstall the air cleaner assembly, being careful to reattach all the vacuum hoses and fittings. These two here, the hot air duct and the cold air duct, are quite important, more important than you may think. They're our subject next week. Until then, I'm Bill Gardner for Motoring 89.
And now, Behind the Wheel with Charlie Goodman.
Why don't we wear our seatbelts? Well, the most common complaint that I am given is the fact that they just are not comfortable. There are some hints I can give you with this. The first one of which is, if you're wearing a jacket such as I am right now, tuck it under your collar so that it's not chafing against your neck. Even better, automotive manufacturers have now created a handy little device that will alter the angle of the seatbelt simply by sliding it up and down on the post. If, like me, you like your seatbelt nice and snug, here's a little tip for you. Simply twist it around itself a few times and then lock it into place, and that takes up the slack between your body and the locking device. Another very good little hint is, as you're putting the seatbelt on and putting it into place, give a good yank on it, locking the inertial reel. Now, without letting out pressure, put it in place, and as you'll see, this belt is completely snug, holding me in almost like a racing harness. A nice, comfortable feeling. You should try it.
Still ahead on Motoring 89, in the lap of luxury.
Car and Driver magazine christened it a striking piece of automotive sculpture. It has a 138 horsepower engine, a drag coefficient that embarrasses the Porsche 911, and a multi-link suspension with optional full-time all-wheel drive. Introducing the 1990 Nissan Access. The first sports car for parents.
There's a rough road ahead with no end in sight. Quaker State engines don't know when to quit.
Quaker State is the only motor oil with QSX, quality engineered to exceed every single car maker's Canadian requirements for maximum engine protection. So pistons are protected from friction mile after mile. Valves are protected from wear year in, year out. That's why Quaker State engines run strong and run long.
Quaker State engines don't know when to quit.
The big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will.
There's no doubt that these Indy cars are constructed with one purpose in mind, speed. Style is important too, but comfort? Well, recently, San Janil observed the construction of a car where style and comfort are top priority.
This is the ultimate transportation for the rich and famous. I mean, I think limousines were created for people to do naughty things behind tinted windows. I love limousines because you can drink a lot of champagne. My dream limousine would be a little faucet inside in the back seat, champagne on tap. And, you know, they are the ultimate creature comfort for anybody.
Television host Robin Leach spends most of his time traveling with the rich and famous. But limo rental companies make the bulk of their business from the general public.
Thanks, Ed.
You're welcome.
Well, it's a night out on the town, a chance to dress up and rent a stretch limo. And with traffic and parking problems in the city, renting a limo is no longer an outlandish expense. The limo business is booming, right down to the stretch limo rental companies, to the production plants that produce these stretch vehicles.
The percentage of glamour, I think, is very small. It's the Saturday night person who wants to hit the town and just show off. Our clientele majority is a corporate clientele. Rates would vary different areas, but the rule of thumb average would be anywhere between $50 to $75 an hour, depends which limousine company you're dealing with. If it's Christmas season, again, it's more expensive. New Year's Eve, I would say, is the prime time of the year. But during the week, off season, it could be as low as $50 an hour. First it was, you know, you get a limo. Now they're looking, can you have something different? So people are getting into Rolls Royces, or they get into stretch Jaguar, Mercedes, something different.
This car was built about 4 years ago in St. Catharines, and it was the first stretch Rolls Royce to be built for public limousines in Toronto. We use it primarily for wedding work. It's very expensive. It rents out for usually between $100 and $150 an hour. And we have a minimum rental of 5 hours on Saturdays for weddings because the demand is so heavy on those days. I guess the resale value of this car now, considering that it's about 12 years old, is about $150,000. But if you were to build a new one, it'd probably cost you about $250,000 at least, maybe close to $300,000.
Just outside Toronto International Airport, there's a sea of limousines for hire. About 400 vehicles like these are for rent in Toronto, but since 1986, the city's licensing commission has put a freeze on livery companies. But that hasn't stopped the production of stretch limousines, at least in this city.
The AHA Limousine Company has been stretching vehicles for over 20 years. Its 100,000 square foot facility in Brampton, Ontario, produces 800 limousines a year, exporting 80% to the U.S.
The limousine actually starts as a Lincoln, as you would know it, exactly the same. There's no special features other than the heavier cooling and suspension that comes with a limo builder's package. We bring the car in, clean it, strip all the interior out of it, and then it gets cut in half, stretched, pre-assembled sides are put into it, it's welded together, floor and roof are put on, and it goes through the paint shops, the trim shops, and finally out here into the final assembly. There's still a lot of handwork in this business. One of the reasons that the big car companies can't come into a market this size is they're highly automated. We have to reproduce those automated effects by hand, and that's the real skill in the specialty car industry. The limousine will cost you somewhere between $60,000 and $70,000, which compares against a Mercedes 560 SEL, which is $105,000, or a Rolls-Royce, which is about $200,000. So, in fact, you can buy a fully loaded, done to the nines limousine and have a driver for less money than buying your own Mercedes.
Legally, there's no length restriction for a stretch limousine. So if you're willing to spend the money, you can let your imagination run wild.
The largest limousine that I've ever been in was 112 feet, and it was so big that it had a jacuzzi in the trunk and one whole golf course along the top roof. You know, you have one of the greatest limousines here in Toronto is a limousine that's made from gold coins all over it, which we featured on Lifestyle. But, you know, they're stretching Rolls Royces, you've seen this. Now they're stretching Ferraris and Lamborghinis. And hopefully we can find a limousine that is warm in this weather, because it's too cold for me to be talking outside with you. So find me a limousine and I'll find you inside it.
Motoring 89 is brought to you by Quaker State. The big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will. If you have any questions or suggestions, drop us a line at Motoring 89, 379 Danforth Avenue, Toronto, Ontario. M4K1P1.
Well, the opening race of the Indy kart season is over here in Phoenix. Rick Mears, a very popular winner. Next week, they'll be in Long Beach, California, and so will Motoring 89. We're now going to leave you with some exciting pit action from the pit of Ludwig Heimrath Jr. of Canada, who finished ninth today. We'll see you next week.